Greetings and welcome back to room 303 in AP English, and we turn now in our study of the Odyssey, finally, to book 22, what Fagles will call Slaughter in the Hall. This is really the Jack book. This is the book we've been waiting for and, of course, building towards, in the same way that when we studied our Iliad and we finally hit book 22 and the contest between Achilles and Hector, we said we've kind of been building towards this. We've always known that this is kind of where we would be, and so finally, we are here. But let's go ahead and say this out loud, and this is why we want to read these books. That is to say, these poems or these works of literature here, book 22 of the Odyssey, why we want to read it and not just let somebody tell us about it. Because when we read it, we're going to meet some really disturbing moral questions that will be a part of this study. And I want us to enjoy those questions. There's some pretty thorny ones. Again, just to remind that the break between book 21 and 22 is artificial. The poet who would have been reciting the poem would not have taken the break at all. For us, though, speaking of the books where we've been, let's return for a brief summary. If you haven't been watching our stuff at learnstrong.net, find that AP folder, and let's do a real quick summary of the 21 books that precede, just so that we're making sure that we're all kind of on board here. Book 1, The Invocation of the Muse, and Telemachus is told it's time to grow up, line 340. Many scholars have argued that Telemachus grows up in book 22 with his first kill and his admission of responsibility for something he did that was wrong, which makes him an adult in some fundamental way. In book 2, he does go in front of the assembly and then he leaves with who he thinks is Mentor, but is actually Athena. That's significant because Mentor will come back in this book as well as Athena for a brief moment. In book 3, he's on Pylos with Nestor. In book 4, he's with Menelaus and Helen. And then at the end of book 4, we have the suitors who are ready to kill Telemachus. The fact that they're plotting to kill Telemachus will give some legitimacy to the fact that Odysseus has a moral right to be able to kill these suitors. Leave that in your mind and on your notes. Book 5, we have Odysseus on Calypso's Isle. He's finally allowed to be released. Book 6, we have him with Nausicaa. Book 7, he's in the island of the Phaeacians. And book 8, we have the Phaeacian games that will take place and the blind prophet Demodocus. And that will be, blind bard poet Demodocus. And that will be significant for us as well, because in this book, we're going to have a reference to a poet again, as we've mentioned before. The flashback books of 9, 10, 11, and 12 tell Odysseus' story in book 9, Polyphemus in book 10, the Laestrygonians and Circe in book 11, the journey to the house of the dead in the underworld in book 12, the Scylla and Charybdis experience, and then the eating of the sun god's cattle. And for that, all of Odysseus' men are jacked. In book 13, the Phaeacians will return Odysseus back to Ithaca. In book 14, Odysseus is with Eumaeus, the swineherd. That will be a significant character as well in book 22. In book 15, Telemachus is with Menelaus and Helen, and he's informed by Athena it's time to go home. In book 16, that's the pivotal book, Odysseus with Telemachus and their plan. We will see that plan come to its fruition. That plan, which is of course created in book 16, will take book 17, 18, 19, 20, and 21 to finally come to its summation in book 22, right? In book 17, Odysseus as the old beggar will show up at the palace and Argos' dog dies. Book 18, we have a fight between Odysseus and Iris, which in many ways prefigures what's about to happen here. In book 19, Odysseus and Telemachus will hide the weapons, and Odysseus and Penelope talk, although Penelope doesn't really know that's who it is. We find out as well about Odysseus's name, meaning the pain man, and we're obviously going to appreciate why that's his name at book 22. Book 20 will actually begin the longest day in the morning, and all of the missed signs by the suitors, Theoclymenus is telling them, you're all going to get jacked. We have an ox hoof that gets thrown at Odysseus by one of one of the suitors, and obviously we're going to come back to see him in book 22. In book 21, that's the stringing of the bow. Odysseus strings the bow, and he tells Eumaeus and Philotes, both of them, the goat herd and the swine herd, the cow herd and the swine herd, that in fact he is Odysseus and it's time now to jack some suitors, right? Again, the hope is that you're reading this along with me and using me to help. Our learning theory is that trying to connect new information to old information, we do that in our reading annotative work. are three levels of reading. Level one, what does the text say? Level two, what does the text mean? And 2A, themes, messages, and 2B. We're concentrating here on symbolism and irony. And if we said the last book was a really influential book for irony, we're going to see a lot of irony and symbolism clearly here. And then finally at level three, well, how can I relate this information? At 3A, we're spending our time with the Iliad. Think about that. Book 22 of the Iliad, as we've mentioned already, is the jack scene between Achilles and Hector. And here, obviously, this is the jack scene between Odysseus and the suitors. And then finally at 3B, how can I relate to this information in some meaningful way? I hope that by the time we're done, I've resurrected one or two questions in your mind that you will grapple with. Let's do a real quick, brief summary. I want to spend most of my time with the actual language of Book 22. Let's do a real quick summary. We begin with Odysseus killing Antinous, and Antinous is drinking wine, and the wine gets spilled, the food gets spilled. That's a significant metaphor all the way around. We've been predicting it. And Odysseus, at line 37, will call the suitors dogs, which is significant. We've been saying that the dog motif has been central from the moment that Argos dies. And really, even before that, when Odysseus is attacked by Eumaeus' dogs, and Eumaeus has to call him off. Next, we have Odysseus, Telemachus, Eumaeus, and Philoetius, the four heroes who will kill all of the suitors in a series of rounds. And finally, we have that pivotal moment with Odysseus killing Leiodes. Now, Leiodes, earlier we saw, was the one who tried first to string the bow, and he couldn't do it. He was kind of wimpy and he couldn't do it, made fun of by Antinous. We have this Leiodes, who is the seer, he's the priest. And you'll remember in my opening lecture, when we began the Odyssey, that I said, for my money, this is the central moment of the entire text. I'm going to talk more at length about why. But it's going to remind us so much of the Iliad, like Achilles killing Lycaon in Iliad 21. Poor Lycaon, the unluckiest man in the world, many have called him. He was caught by Achilles under a pear tree. He was shipped away, sold off as a slave, finally made it back to Troy. And then, bad luck again, comes into face-to-face with Achilles. He drops, of course, his weaponry and begs, supplicates to Achilles to save his life, and Achilles is having none of it. Likewise, because Odysseus chops off the head of Leiodes, this priest seer, this will remind us in Iliad 10 of the way that Dolon's head got chopped off as well. Odysseus, however, does save Phemius, the poet, the bard. And then we have, finally, at the end of this book, Odysseus calling out the 12 women that Eurycleia will say, these are the women that were not good supporters of yours, and they slept with the men and that kind of thing. They're forced to clean up all of the disgusting blood and guts of all the men. Of course, some of those men were their lovers, right? And then ultimately taken out and jacked. Odysseus tells his son to cut them into pieces. Telemachus will show some mercy by hanging all of them. And then Melanthus, who has been captured during this sequence, is going to be treated in the most disturbing of fashions. This of Melanthus is never going to make it into a film version, usually, of the Odyssey, for reasons we'll get into. And then finally, Odysseus will purge the house and will weep with a few of the women who have been loyal to him, setting up, obviously, Book 23 and the moment when finally Odysseus and his girl Penelope will come face to face. Let's go to work now with the language of this. And as I've said before, every time I've been with you, I've said that it would make sense that we read all of this. I just don't have the time. But I think there's some questions we want to put in our notes right away. Part of this is the moral question. Is revenge ever okay? And what about those who surrender and are going to get killed anyway? And what about women in terms of that? This book is, in many ways, we would argue, the most like the Iliad in that we have gratuitous violence. And so, not spoiler alert necessarily, but let's just say this out loud. This is a very disturbing book. In fact, I have students that will say, this may be some of the most disturbing stuff I've read. And once I recognize the questions that Homer is challenging me to ask myself and my culture, this is a really disturbing book. We have two really important Achilles versus Odysseus kinds of moments, and I've already referenced them. We're going to be looking for them. One of them is going to reference the sons of Achilles and Odysseus. You'll remember that early on, when Odysseus was having a conversation with Achilles in the underworld, the question came up about Achilles' boy. We're going to come back to that conversation in this book. And then I've already mentioned that really famous exchange between Achilles and Lycaon when he kills a helpless man, right? He says, well, Patroclus was a lot better man than you. And look at me, I'm so big and strong and I'm going to die. So just get right with it and die. You can go back and take a look at book 21 of that, that famous exchange in the lecture I've already given. It opens this way. Now, stripping back his rags, Odysseus, master of craft and battle, vaulted onto the great threshold, gripping his bow and quiver, bristling arrows, and poured his flashing shafts before him loose at his feet, and thundered out to all the suitors. Before he jacks him, he's got to say something. Look, he says, your crucial test is finished, that none of them could string the bow. Now, at last, but another target's left that no one's hit before. We'll see if I can hit it. Apollo, give me glory. The fact that he calls on Apollo, it's Apollo's feast day. Apollo, obviously, the great archer. And, of course, we began the Iliad with Apollo, didn't we? With that, he trained a stabbing arrow at Antinous, just lifting a gorgeous golden loving cup in his hands, just tilting the two-handed goblet back to his lips, about to drain the wine and slaughter the last thing on the suitor's mind. Who could dream that one foe in that crowd of feasters, however great his power, would bring down death on himself and black doom? But Odysseus aimed and shot Antinous square in the throat, and the point went stabbing clean through the soft neck and out. This is language we're very familiar with from our Iliad study. And off to the side he pitched Antinous. The cup dropped from his grasp as the shaft sank home, and the man's lifeblood came spurting from his nostrils, thick red jets, a sudden thrust of his foot. He kicked away the table. Food showered across the floor, the bread and meat soaked in a swirl of bloody filth. Now, this is surprising language to those who have not read the Iliad. To those of us who have studied closely the Iliad, this is not surprising language. We're going to have a lot of Iliad-like language like this in our, you know, in our text. Of course, the spilling of the wine takes us back to book 18, line 445, and that steward who got jacked and with a stool that was thrown and all of that. The suitors don't get it. They say things like, your game is over, you've shot your last, you'll never escape your headlong death, you kill the best in Ithaca, our fine prince, vultures will eat your corpse. We're told at line 33, groping, frantic, each one persuading himself the guest had killed a man by chance. They still don't get it, that is to say, they don't see. We go back to Polyphemus, blinded. Poor fools, blind to the fact that all their necks were in the noose, their dooms sealed. With a dark look, we know about these dark looks of Odysseus, the wily fighter Odysseus shouted back, you dogs, back to Argos. You never imagined I'd return from Troy so cocksure that you bled my house to death, ravished my serving women, those poor women, of course, are going to be punished for this fact, wooed my wife behind my back while I was still alive. Of course, the reality is that they didn't know he was still alive. What Odysseus seems to be suggesting is that they should have sent out messages to try and find. In other words, what Telemachus went in search for, any one of these suitors could have gone in search for, and they never actually did. And then he says it. The reason you're going to get punished is no fear of the gods who rule the skies up there. No fear that man's revenge might arrive someday. Now all your necks are in the noose. Second time he said it. Your doom is sealed. And it's at this point that Eurymachus jumps up and tries to negotiate, maybe language. He says, if you're truly Odysseus of Ithaca, home at last, you're right to accuse us. However, Antinous is the one who did all of this. You've killed him. He got what he deserved. Spare your own people. He says it at line 58. Later we'll recoup your costs with a tax laid down upon the land, reminding us what Alcyonus said in book 13, line 15, about taxing the people to be able to pay for all of the gifts they gave to Odysseus, right? In other words, we're going to give you lots of Scooby snacks, lots of tea mate. This will remind us that Odysseus himself was the one, on behalf of Agamemnon, who offered this kind of opportunity of Timae to Achilles in Iliad 9, and Achilles said no. No, Eurymachus, Odysseus will report back at line 65. Not if you paid me all your father's wealth, all you possess now, and all that could pour in from the world's end. No, not even then would I stay my hands from slaughter till all you suitors had paid for all your crimes. Now, life or death, your choice. Fight me or flee if you hope to escape your sudden bloody doom. I doubt one man in the lot will save his skin. Well, obviously they can't flee because their doors are all locked. In other words, they're helpless, they're defenseless, and Odysseus is going to slaughter every last one of them for their crimes. Now already, let's ask the moral question we'll come back to. Is it fair to, excuse me, is it fair to kill defenseless men who have not actually killed anybody? Okay, let's put that in our notes. Odysseus is saying, you deserve to die for your crimes, but what have been their crimes? Well, an inappropriate Xenia practice, we would argue, right? Maybe some sexual infidelities, although Odysseus is one to talk. But certainly these guys haven't been going out and killing people, and yet Odysseus is certain that justice is to slaughter every last one of them. Eurymachus will speak to his suitors now, and he will say to them, so, he says, line 77, fight, call up the joy of battle, swords out, tables lifted, block his arrows, winging death, charge him in a pack. This will remind us that in book 17, line 185, we were told they were practicing with their discus and spears, so now it's time to actually use these. You get the sense that these suitors have, most of them, have never been in a fighting contest before, and to that degree, Odysseus is obviously his old hand. We know this from our study of the Iliad. Odysseus knows how to crank on people. And so these poor blokes, they got no idea how to fight at all. Odysseus then will kill Eurymachus at line 85. In the same breath, Odysseus loosed an arrow, ripping his breast beside the nipple so hard it lodged in the man's liver. Out of his grasp, the sword dropped to the ground. Over his table, head over heels, he tumbled, doubled up, flinging his food and his two-handed cup across the floor. This spilling of the wine, spilling of food, we said was going to be an important one. Amphinous, then, is going to be killed by Telemachus. That will be Telemachus's first kill. And then Telemachus will say to Odysseus, we need weapons. I'm going to go to the storeroom and get weapons. Telemachus will go and get armor. Odysseus keeps killing. Out of arrows, Telemachus shows up. He armors up, very much like the Aristeia of any number of warriors that we saw in the Iliad. And then it will be Angelius, one of the suitors, who will then step up. And he will call at line 140 to his friends, friends, can't someone climb through a hatch and tell men outside to sound the alarm and be quick? And it will be the goat herd Melanthius then who will answer, yeah, not a chance. But he says, you know what, I'm gonna crawl through the ducts of the ductwork. Apparently there's ductwork in this palace of some kind. And I'm gonna get you guys all weaponry. So Melanthius to the end is in support of the suitors. Odysseus then will see that they have weapons. And Odysseus will immediately assume at line 160, one of the women tipped the odds against us. Or could it be the goat herd? But it's Telemachus at 162. Now this is an important moment. My fault, father, he says. The blame's all mine. Telemachus could easily not have told his father this, not have owned up. What makes a young man into an adult? The poet seems to suggest that it's about ownership, responsibility, accepting responsibility. This is one of the things the suitors never willingly do. Telemachus says, the blame's all mine. That stunk door to the vault, I left it ajar. They kept a better watch than I. Go, Eumaeus, shut the door to the storeroom. Check and see if it's one of the women's tricks. Or Dolius' son, Melanthius. He's our man, I'd say. Eumaeus then will come back and he will speak to Odysseus and he asks, do I kill this man, Melanthius, or do I just simply tie him up? Odysseus will say, tie him up. They have plans for him later and those will be tragic plans. However, let him dangle in agony as you hang him up. Don't let him die. Still alive for a good long time. So they're going to torture Melanthius before they finally kill him. They catch Melanthius. That's exactly what they do. Eumaeus then will mock Melanthius as they strap him up to the rafters. He says, now stand guard through the whole night, Melanthius, stretched out on a soft bed fit for you, your highness. You're bound to see the morning rising up from the ocean, mounting her golden throat. In other words, we're going to do some nasties to you. And then we have Athena who will show up as mentor, and this is fascinating at 215 or so. Odysseus was thrilled to see her. Odysseus immediately recognizes her as Athena, and he said, even though it's mentor, rescue us, mentor, now it's life or death. Remember your old comrade, all the service I offered you. We were boys together. So he cried. Yet he knew in his bones it was Athena, driver of armies. But across the hall, the suitors brayed against mentor, and you have Angelus who is going to say in threatening language, he's going to say, if you help at all, you're seriously getting jacked. Naked threats were told at 235. Athena hit new heights of rage. She lashed out at Odysseus now with blazing accusation. So you've got Mentor, who in some ways is going to taunt Odysseus into greater action. The way that, for example, we saw Hector taunting Paris in the Iliad, trying to make him a better warrior. For example, she says, "Where's it gone, Odysseus? Your power, your fighting heart. The great soldier who fought for famous white-armed Helen." We have several mentions of Helen at the very end of the Odyssey, and here's one. "Battling Trojans 9 long years, nonstop, no mercy, mowing their armies down in grueling battle. You, who seized the broad streets of Troy with your fine strategic stroke." In other words, I'm sorry, aren't you the one who invented that Trojan horse? By the way, can you imagine if your suitors and Telemachus hearing Mentor say, "You are the reason Troy fell, you. And here you are whining about a few men you can't take care of and you need my help?" Now she says, "You've returned to your own house, your own wealth. Bewail the loss of your combat strength and the war with suitors." Again, we're going back. Are you not strong enough? In other words, she's kind of taunting him. "I thought you were stronger than this. Come, old friend, stand by me. You'll see action now. See how Mentor, the son of Alcamenes, fight. That brave fighter kills your enemies, pays you back for service." Rousing words were told, but then, like a swallow, a bird, she flies up onto the perch to watch. And immediately Odysseus recognizes that, in fact, it is Athena. And, of course, for that, he has a new heart. The suitors now will fight, and we'll go through this very quickly. You can read this on your own. I'm not going to read all this to you, but Angelus will lead the suitors. And they all say, "Let's throw spears together." But it's Athena who makes all six spears, miss them. And Odysseus then will say, "Let's hurl," and we have our first round of kills. Odysseus will, each one of the men, Odysseus, Telemachus, the swineherd, the cowherd cuts down Pisander, for example. They all have their first round of kills. Again, the suitors will throw their spears. Again, the suitors will miss. However, we are told at line 290 that True and Amphibion will nick Telemachus on the wrist. The glancing blade just barely broke his skin, which will take us back to book 11 and Odysseus's conversation with Achilles about Neoptolemus, Achilles's boy, when he asked about him. And Odysseus said, you know, he left the battle at Troy unscarred at book 11, line 609. And for that, Achilles goes dancing off happy because his son was a great and mighty warrior.